It is Thursday, the 23rd of May. It's the off-season. We're in the pub. This is the Cat's Whiskers podcast. Well, hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whenever you happen to be listening. This is the first off-season podcast. Myself and Adam and Ant are around the table. Say hello, gentlemen.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hello, gentlemen.
Oh, my good God. Pete, Ant, the pair of you. Yes, here we are on the eve of the announcement of the general election. I promise you there is absolutely no correlation. I mean, you know, we might try and sneak ourselves onto a few ballot posts. I mean, we couldn't do much worse, frankly.
Oh, we've alienated all of the Conservative listeners straight away.
Well, no, I didn't specify a party. As my dearly departed grandfather once said to a Labour councillor who came to his doorstep before my grandmother could stop him, "You're all a bunch of crooks anyway." So, and I feel like he might have been onto something, bless him. So anyway, that's enough politics on a hockey podcast. That's about as much as I can stomach anyway. We've got potentially a lot to get through. And I say potentially because last week Ant sat down with Scott Findlay and Lewis Callant, Blaze fans, to talk about the coaching swap, essentially. We'll come back to that in a moment. But we're going to sort of play this by ear, see how much myself, Adam and Ant talk about everything. And what we may end up doing is popping that out as a separate podcast, but we'll see. We'll see how much waffle there is, and then we'll judge it closer to the time.
We might split this into two parts, you know. We'll see. We're easy, aren't we? We're in flux.
I mean, you,
we normally have a schedule that we just completely ignore and talk and ramble on anyway. So.
I know. Yeah, yeah. So
you two might be rambling on because my mouth is completely numb at the moment because I've just had some loaded fries with chilies all over them, and quite frankly, talking's a bit of a problem.
Well, I mean, glass of milk for table one, I think, is probably the order of the day. So, I think the first thing, while it's fresh in everybody's minds, I think the best thing we can do is that basically, I mean, welcome Adam back into the country is the first thing.
They let me back in.
Yeah, yeah.
Unbelievable.
You've been allowed. And you didn't get arrested while you were out there, so well done. So anybody who's not aware, Adam has taken over the mantle of King of the Socials for a little while, and he's been posting about his exploits over in Prague watching the World Championships. Following Team GB with some of our other fellow podcast contributors, Zara, Sarah and Gemma, and also Andy for a short time.
And
our Belfast correspondent, Noel Gillespie, who decided just randomly to, casually inquire as to everybody's status over in Prague, and then just appeared. So, I mean, you know, full marks for spontaneity there, Noel. So, Adam, how was it, I suppose?
Wow. It was an amazing experience. It really was. I think I've never done anything quite like that in terms of hockey. It was just absolute wall-to-wall hockey. The whole city, the whole country has sort of gone hockey crazy. And it was just really magical to sort of be immersed in that and, you know, see a different sort of hockey culture. Because over here, obviously, hockey is a, you know, very firmly a minority sport. But over there, it's a way of life. And it's just the whole enormity of it. It's a big deal for them. And they're sort of wanting to host a really good games. And they are putting on a really good World Championships out there. Fantastic event, and but there's, you know, Prague's an amazing city, absolutely stunning. You run out of superlatives to describe it. You know, there's just so much to look at, so much that's old, so much that's new, and quite a lot in between. So, city's amazing. The hockey was amazing. You know, just mixing with fans from, you know, other nations was incredible as well. You know, it's amazing that, you know, we still continue to surprise fans of other countries that actually little old GB plays ice hockey. And every time you sort of get spotted wearing your GB shirt, you know, someone will come and seat you out and shake your hand or sort of like tap you on the back or give you a bit of respect. And, you know, that was really novel. So, yeah, it was just a really, really fantastic experience. I'd never done it before. Definitely won't be the last time I do it as well. I know ultimately, you know, GB got relegated, which is the outcome nobody wanted. But, you know, putting that aside, the whole experience of being out there and, you know, just like absolutely being consumed by hockey for 11 days was, you know, something that I never really even got close to experiencing before. So really recommend it. You know, if anyone else can get the chance to do it in the future, you know, when we get back to the top division and the world championships, not if, when, I'm sure will happen, then do it. You know, I really recommend it.
Yeah. I mean, we weren't jealous at all, were we, Ant?
No. No. I mean, I was lucky enough to have been... This is why it's taken us so long to get together, you know, after the news of the, you know, the coach swap and everything. I was away the week before it all started, and you've been on a hen do. Mm. So it's not like we haven't had things to do, but yeah, it is frustrating when you're sat back at the office or what have you, and your pals are just sending you pictures of food and beer and fan parks and annoying mascots and stuff.
Hey, so they're not annoying. not annoying.
Oh my God, on behalf of the rest of the crew, I think they found him quite. No, he sounds like, you know. Obviously got to watch all the games on Premier Sports, bar the Austria game, typically.
So it's your fault?
Yeah, it probably is my fault. Although, no, Adam blames the flag. They got us a flag made up, didn't they? And they put a flag out. But, no, you know, fair play to GB. The game against Canada was a fantastic performance. We should have beaten the Danes. And I think even Denmark will hold their hands up.
Yeah.
And no, they were given a game, and they got the rub of the green with the calls there. And unfortunately, the one game where we needed to turn up, they were like rabbits in headlights to stick on the mascot mascot train. But it was nice to see our boys do well. I think I know Tetlow didn't play every game, but he certainly didn't put a foot wrong, you know, in the games he did play. And Ollie was like the Ollie of old. So yeah, I mean, we have had some engagement. That's the word, yeah. So Jack, who has been quiet over the last few podcasts, but he has been in touch.
Hey, look, don't poke the bear.
And one of his questions was about Ollie.
Yep.
And I just thought, he's a nice, you know, nice springboard.
Go on, yeah, let's do it, let's go.
You know, he wants to see Ollie now step up and be the franchise Brit. Adam, you were there in person. Yep. Tina, me and you watched him on telly. He did look like the only Betteridge that we had before he went on his European vacation, didn't he?
He did. I thought that he was fantastic. Oh, Ant's coughing over the other side of the table. You all right, mate? Yeah. You okay? Yeah, I mean, I actually thought Ollie was our player of the tournament. And the GB Supporters Club go around before the final game with sort of slips of paper and ask members to write their player of the tournament on it. I went for Ollie, but sadly, I didn't quite get the slip back to where it needed to go. But, you know, he wasn't...
So it's your fault.
But he wasn't in the top three, so I don't think my single vote would have made much difference to the outcome of that vote. But maybe with my black and gold tinted specs on, I thought Ollie was really, really good in every game. You know, he brought the energy. His skating was, you know, back to where we expected it to. And he just made an impact. You know, he was always there. I thought Ollie was one of the players, actually, that looked like he wasn't out of place on that stage. And I know that sounds quite crazy when you've got, like, Canada there, you've got, you know, other major hockey-playing nations there, but Ollie didn't look out of place. And I think his work rate was just off the charts. He was, you know, both ends of the ice, up, down, up, down, up, down. You know, he looked energised. Now, that might have been because he missed quite a bit of last season. So, you know, there isn't the sort of wear and tear on his body that, you know, the other players have got. But, yeah, I mean, that bodes really well for what we're getting next year from Ollie. You know, if he's back to anywhere near his best, and he wants to sort of step his game up again and take it to another level, then, you know, that's a win-win for us, isn't it?
Be the franchise fruit,
like Jack says.
Yeah, exactly.
Most definitely. And I mean, that first game against Canada, I think it's probably fair to say we were all dreading it, dreading what the scoreline could potentially be. But you know, it sounds terrible, doesn't it? But, you know, 4-2 was actually a decent scoreline for GB.
You get to the point where you're pulling your net here against the number one team in the world, multi-time world champions, you know, back-to-back NHL. Yes, it was the first game of the tournament. Yes, you can say Canada were therefore rusty. It's the first time that lot have played together. You know, there are a lot of players that arrive late because of, you know, various teams getting knocked out at certain points of the playoffs and what have you. But yeah, it was fantastic, wasn't it? I mean, I hope everybody in the GB fan base who was at the game managed to get a picture of the scoreboard.
I did.
at 1-0. I mean, it could have been 2 as well, really, you know.
Like I said, for 30 seconds, we were better at hockey than Canada. Which, you know, something that I never thought I'd say, but it was incredible. And, you know, we saw some Canadians after that game, and they walked past us, and they actually said, Liam Kerr, what a hell of a player. And he, you know, in that first game, he was just unreal. But I thought everybody in a GB jersey in that game stepped up. You know, they had to. You know, if you don't turn up for those sorts of games, we would have lost, you know, 11-12-0.
Whistle had a really good game.
Whistle was really, really good. And, you know, I think a lot of the players probably wanted to elevate their games because it was Canada. You know, they wanted to sort of like, well, not only did they want to get the tournament off to a good start, but they wanted to, you know, make a mark and show that they belonged at that level. And they were brilliant. And, you know, that whole game and the whole experience against Canada was fantastic. The one disappointment for me, other than not turning up against Norway for the first period, was the 8-0 defeat against Finland the following day. Now, I think me and Ant were talking about this before we started recording the podcast, but I still think it's because we gave so much in that first game. You know, we really did sort of like empty the tanks, as it were, but we just couldn't cope with Finland's skating style as well. They're an incredibly fast team, and I think we had some tired legs on you know, that roster for us, on that for the players. So I can sort of understand why we lost that second game to Finland, but, you know, that maybe my disappointment, because you think, well, after doing really, really well against Canada, you know, putting a real marker down for the tournament, there was so much to build from, and then, you know, a lot of that momentum just instantly crumbles the next day. But yeah, going back to Canada, brilliant performance by everybody. Everybody that was on the ice with GB, including the coaching staff behind the benches as well. You know, they really brought their A games to that. And, you know, I think a lot of people probably went away from that game thinking, wow, actually, GB, they might be a force in this tournament.
Yeah. And you sort of reference that second to last game where, you know, we had to win, we didn't. And then the following game, obviously, you know, we take a win finally. Liam Kerr didn't play that game.
No.
And I think it forced the rest of them to step up.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a cliche, you know, we've said that very two-word phrase, you know, a few times, but it did mean that, you know, they weren't looking for that one guy to be the playmaker, that, because that one guy wasn't there, so they had to find another way. I managed to watch like the last period of that, because, you know, I have a job, unfortunately. But, you know, from what I saw, it just seemed like a good team performance.
I mean, yes. I mean, like I say, it's the one game I watched, but, you know, from the highlights, from what I've heard from speaking to the gang that were at the game and what have you, it was also maybe a case of like the shackles were off a little bit. You know, we already knew our fate, so we just went out. And also a bit of Austria also, because if they'd won, they had a chance of the going through to the knockout stages. So yeah, maybe they were a bit sort of, as we were against Norway the night before, a little bit sort of, you know, unsure about, although they did take the lead for saying that, but no, overall, I think, you know, you've got to take your positives. don't know where the next tournament's going to be. There's potentially, I mean, you look at the nations that are in that league, we have to be in a very, very good place to host again, which would give us an excellent chance of bouncing straight back. I know obviously Belfast did it a few years ago. We did it last year, so maybe it was Sheffield's turn. Do you fancy a cold night in Sheffield this time next in the May, or I don't know?
I mean, are they going to build a few pubs around the arena? Because, I mean, otherwise, it's a non-starter, let's face it.
Get the tram, man. Come on.
Oh, trams. Prague trams. I'm already missing them.
apparently Noel is not, after having damaged himself. I mean, it's kind of his fault for being so tall, but, you know. We'll leave it there.
Welcome tall in Northern Ireland. There's a reason they call the Giants.
Yes, indeed. Indeed. Quite. Right. Okay. So let's move on to some news closer to home now then. So one or two things to sort of unpack. As we've already alluded to, and I mean, unless you've been living under a rock, you obviously...
Not the rock.
Under a rock, then you cannot have failed to notice that we've had a little switcheroo with the Coventry Blaze, wherein they get Kevin Moore and we get Danny Stewart. So I think on that day the coaching announcement was made, as the kids say, the WhatsApp group was lit, quite frankly. I think there is a difference of opinion amongst the group, I would say, in terms of the appointment of the Nottingham Panthers coach, Danny Stewart. Gentlemen, who would like to come in on this first?
Well, I mean, yeah, I was just thinking this is a perfect time to segue into like my chat with Scott and Lewis. But, it's kind of rumoured, wasn't it? As a kind of a jokey type thing, I think. You know, Sarah had mentioned that, you know, he was a potential coach for us, and we all laughed it off, didn't we?
Well, no, I had heard the same thing from somebody else, that he had been interviewed. So, but you know, it's like most rumours, you don't really pay it much mind. You sort of, you know, you'll kind of have a laugh about it, or, you know, despair about it, depending on how you feel about said rumour. But yes, I think the rumours were strong around playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, like you say, the initial reaction was, I mean, you'll hear it in the, you know, when we play the chat that I had with Scott and Lewis, because they asked me in my opinion as well. My initial reaction was one of extreme disappointment. A little bit of anger, if I'm honest. I think the phrase "you can stick your season ticket up your" was uttered. But the more, not sorry, Tina, I know you're getting upset by the word "more" getting mentioned there, but
no, it's all right. I'm over it now. I'm over it.
Come on to him later. The more you know, as time has gone on, the more I've spoken to, like I say, the chat that I had with Lewis and Scott, fans of the Blaze, other Panthers fans, which kind of all talked it between us. The more I thought about it, sat down and thought about it, the more I'm liking it. I think this is potentially a genius appointment by us. We've tried the rookie coach in Wallace, and yes, we won the COVID Cup. Unfortunately, you know, that doesn't really count in the grand scheme of things. We've tried the hardline North American. We've tried the suave European.
But to be fair, there were some extenuating circumstances with that. I am of the firm belief that had everything that last season not happened, I am of the firm belief that we would be seeing Paraday and Moore back as a coaching tandem at the Nottingham Panthers. That's my personal opinion.
I don't doubt that at all. And, we would have been on for, maybe not winning the league, but we would have been right up there, I think, come the end of the season. We were certainly made a run at the playoffs as well. But but this is now, you know, we're now trying someone who knows the Elite League and who knows the Elite League more than, you know, Danny Stewart. You know, if you look around on the coaching staff that we've got around the Elite League now, he was an arse on the ice against us. I mean, we had some fantastic battles against him.
Oh, one of the first times I went up to Scott, in fact, the first time I went up to Kirkcaldy, Stevie Lee was filling Danny Stewart in, yeah. and it was brilliant.
It was
off a face off, just in front of the must have been the team bench. Yeah, it must have been the team bench. But yeah, my first game up at Kirkcaldy.
Yeah, we've had some battles against him, and I think if anything, that with the carryover from last season, it was clear that Paraday had a very close connection with his team. He was very close to the team, and what have you. And I mean, you'll hear it when we speak to Scott in particular, because he works, you know, he does the media side for the Blaze. Danny's very much of that ilk when it comes to looking after his team and what have you. So yeah, I'm now back to all in, to use the quote. When I actually hit the renewal button, anyway.
You've had quite the journey, you have.
But yeah, you know, like I say, I think there's. I want to hear some more from him. You know, coming forward, I want to start hearing some interviews with him. I think it's a very, very astute pickup by us, and I think the time was right for him to leave Coventry as well.
I just got that pun. Was that even a pun? Were you intending to do that? A Stuart?
I don't think so.
Come on, I am. Give me some credit. I do like to know the thing that I know what I'm planning on saying every so often.
Well, I've mostly got no idea.
What do you think?
I was going to go to Adam.
Well,
no, it's fine.
He's
fine. Look, there's a pint of ice water. There was a pint of ice water in front of him. It's nearly all gone, so he's fine.
Half a thing of Tic Tacs since.
Yeah. Tic Tacs are not going to save you, my friend. Anyway, so yes, coaching appointment.
Yeah, I think when it was announced, it was a case of, it was like a real, that's a bit of a head scratcher. I couldn't sort of see the logic in it. So, I mean, I've pretty much gone on the same journey as Anne in thinking what the heck's going on initially. And then, you know, as time's gone on, as the days have passed, you know, I've sort of thought about it a bit more. And, yeah, I mean, look, his experience in the Elite League, you just can't knock. He's been behind a bench now for many, many years. And he knows the scene in the country. He knows, you know, the rivalries, he knows how teams generally play and how they operate. So to get him from Coventry, look, I think, you know, he was probably working under a very different set of circumstances in Coventry to how he'll be operating here in Nottingham. And I'd just like to think that he might benefit from that sort of reset, much like Coventry might benefit from the reset, you know, with a new coach, you know, with Kevin Moore. So I think, yeah, you know, Ant's onto something there. He could be quite a canny signing for us. And, you know, if he's allowed to sort of work with a bit of a bigger budget than what he was traditionally used to working with in Coventry, then, you know, let's see, you know, some good signings from him. He's probably got a very extensive range of contacts that he can draw from. I think the one thing that I've got a little bit of concern about is, I think Danny Stewart's hockey is very sort of like workmanlike. You know, his brand of hockey is sort of like very gritty and, you know, might not have the level of offence and sort of finesse that Nottingham fans might like and maybe have got used to over the years from like Corey Nielsen teams, etc. So I think that's going to be an interesting thing to try and square. But, you know, he might have to sort of buy into the organisation's approach and, you know, what Omar wants for the sort of the team on the ice. You know, do we want to see entertaining hockey? Yeah, of course we want to see entertaining hockey. Do we want to see winning hockey? Well, yeah, we want to see winning hockey. If you can sort of blend those two things together, then obviously you're onto a massive winner. So, you know, after what happened last year, I think we're all sort of recalibrating what our expectations are for the season ahead. I say season ahead, we've just finished, not last season, but you know what I mean, next season.
No, I think the terminology is sound.
Yeah, I think so. But yeah, I think we're all having to sort of like say, well, what is a realistic expectation for the Nottingham Panthers next year? And, you know, we need to be well away from the bottom of the standings. Of course, we want to be, you know, improving on what happened last season. But, you know, would I take a top five finish if there are 10 teams in the league again next year like there were this year? Yeah, I think I would. I think I would, because we need that progress and we need to build some momentum. You both talked about how it was cut short with Paraday going home and Kevin Moore leaving. I agree. You know, any other circumstance, those two are still there behind the bench next year and we progress and we might have finished, I don't know, fourth in the season just finished, and we might be like looking at maybe knocking on the door of like breaking that sort of Sheffield, Cardiff and Belfast stranglehold.
Yeah, I would say so. Sorry, Ant, you wanted to come in?
Yeah, I completely forgot what I meant to think now because I started thinking about something else. One thing I did want to mention is Danny, historically, if you look at the teams that he signed for the Blaze, generally they've got a really good netminder.
Yeah.
And I know that was one area in particular where we wanted to improve on last season. For all, you know, the times where Robinson and Rock played really well, there was also times where, I mean, certainly Rock towards the end of the season looked knackered, didn't he?
But burnout.
But I mean, Danny's got an eye for a decent netminder, so hopefully, you know, that comes in. And I'll try and think about what the other thing I was going to say. Tina, what are your thoughts on it?
Yeah, well,
again, you were very much like the same thing, weren't you? You were like, I'm done. I'm certainly not all in.
I mean, right. So, I apologise most profoundly in advance to Chris Ellis, who I've been speaking to, and we've been trying to sort of foster some links, and it's for one reason or another, it hasn't quite happened, and I might be in one foul swoop about to destroy that, but I hope I can do it with a little decorum. So yes, when the announcement was made, I was, and I remain, thoroughly underwhelmed. Now, I accept everything that both of you have said, and I completely appreciate the position that we find ourselves in at the moment as, you know, as the Nottingham Panthers, you know, collectively. I understand all of that, and I understand that, you know, a team that finishes ninth in a league of 10 teams is not exactly an attractive prospect. And a team that comes...
eighth or seventh previous season?
Well, yeah, exactly. But also, you know, a team that comes with as much baggage as we now have from last season. I appreciate that, you know, it's not always... You're not always going to find coaches who... are going to say, yeah, I want that challenge, and I, you know, coming in and knowing nothing about, you know, about anything that's happened, you know, nothing from the inside, because obviously, you know, the eyes of the world were upon us last season, but knowing nothing about how this league operates, what the priorities are, and what you've got to do to succeed, I remain underwhelmed by this coaching appointment, because Danny Stewart is yet to win a trophy, and I don't accept the budget argument, because I'm sorry, but our owner is not known for flashing the cash. I don't see that.
I'm with you on that. I mean, yeah. There's been a lot of talk about budgets and what's he going to be like with a bigger budget. I'm not convinced that our budget is going to was any that much further away. I mean, you can look at, obviously, attendances at the Blaze the last couple of seasons have been shocking, so they've not got the money coming in there. Whereas everywhere else in the league, the attendances are going up, except in Coventry. But you know how tight is Black is with his purse strings and what have you. I'm not convinced that the budgets are that far different.
I don't think there's a substantial enough difference for there to be that argument in place. So, here is...
I would argue that Coventry have put a better team on the ice over the last couple of seasons. I mean, yes, last season, you take that into account, but they still finished above us. But, you know, before that, you know, you go back... I mean, again, this is brought up in the chat that I had with Lewis and Scott. That the COVID season, when the lockout began, you know, the lockdown began, Coventry were in touching chance of like being league challengers. The Blaze were battering everybody. You know, it's
apart from us when they saw the whites of Sam Hare's eyes.
Yeah, I'm just trying to turn you around a little bit.
It's not right. Let me put it online.
Bold is best.
No, right.
Yeah,
no.
I'll
test that. Yeah. Well, you know, you're biased. But. And I forgot my thread. You've interrupted me, and I allowed you to interrupt me. How dare I? Because I normally let you to do all the talking. No, it's fine. Go on.
I've got something to say, but if you...
No, I'm not done yet.
Remember what you've said.
But I'm not... I'm sure I'll get there. So, basically, I want to be wrong. Don't get me... You know, don't misunderstand me. I am not sitting here saying I want the new coach of the Nottingham Panthers to fail just so I can be right. I want to be so thoroughly wrong that, Danny Stewart can stand in front of me at the end of the season and just stand there with a big smug grin on his face and say, how do you like me now, you know, sort of thing. I want that so much because... And I'm struggling to I'm just going to have to say the thing I wanted to say. And if we ever get to a point, or if we ever get the opportunity to interview Danny Stewart, one of the questions I want to ask him, and potentially I would ask this of Omar Pasha as well, what in Danny Stewart's record aligns him with the ambitions of the Nottingham Panthers? Because there's nothing in his coaching record that says that he's going to be the guy that is going to bring trophies to Nottingham. We should be, and we're not by any stretch of the imagination, we should be one of the big clubs. We have everything in place. We have everything that we should need to be successful. But we're not. But I don't see how this coaching appointment changes that. And again, I want to be wrong. I absolutely want to be wrong, but I'm just... To quote one of our podcast alumni, I'm not confident.
What? I'm trying to persuade you to maybe take a bit of a softer view on Danny Stewart. What I would say is, after the season that we've just experienced and encountered, you need a strong character to be your coaching figurehead. Now, I don't know a lot about Danny Stewart as a person. I know that his teams play gritty hockey, and I know that he, you know, is a real sort of competitor. You only have to go back to when he played the game, you know, and we're all old enough to have seen Danny Stewart play in the Elite League. You know, he's a gritty guy, you know, that always stands his ground and doesn't back down. And I wonder whether Omar and Neil Black want somebody like that in charge of the Panthers next season, who is strong, you know, has character. Okay, I fully accept that, you know, Danny Stewart is not a winning coach in that sense because he doesn't have the accolades and the trophies to, like, fall back on. But, you know, if he's a strong character and he can, you know, foster a real sort of close-knit locker room with the signings that he makes, you know, a lot of new signings and a few returnees, hopefully, then it's going to be progress. And I think we will progress up the standings this year, next year, sorry, keep making that mistake.
It is this year.
Well, I suppose it's the same calendar year. It depends on what the expectations and aspirations of the management of this club are. You know, do they want...
And that is the thing that troubles me, because, like I say, what in this coach's record aligns him with what we aspire to?
Well, look, I think Danny Stewart can get you quite comfortably to the middle of the standings. I think he can get you to fifth. But the problem is then, does Danny Stewart have the tools at his disposal and the calibre of coaching acumen to get himself above an Aaron Fox, to get himself above an Adam Keefe, to get himself above a... Blimey, I forgot the Cardiff coach, even though I've seen him most of the week. I've seen him so many times in Prague in the last 11 days. Yeah, Pete Russell. Does he have the ability to out-coach them and to put together better rosters, you know, more competitive rosters? I, like you, Tina, remain unconvinced by that. So I think this is a transitional appointment, you know, to get us a little bit up the standings. But whether we can get all the way to actually, you know, knocking on the door of being Elite League title contenders, you know, I need convincing of that, and I'll need to see a good solid season this coming season to, you know, reinforce my belief that there is potential for Danny Stewart to take us to the top of ice hockey in this country.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be on. I remain unmoved. I'm sorry, Adam. It was a very, very passionate plea. That's there, right. But.
I totally get it, because, like I say, my thought process and your thought, we were very much almost word for word alike in our initial reaction to his appointment and what have you. My and it might be the blind optimism that, you know, I still believe, you know, what I said in our last podcast, next season we're winning the whole damn lot. And at this moment in time, there are 10 teams in the Elite League that can say exactly the same thing, and we're one of them. So, yeah. But it's just like I say, from an experience thought process alone, his knowledge of the Elite League and how to win games, he knows how to win in Sheffield. And you'll hear in the chat that I have with Scott and Lewis, he hates Sheffield with a passion. He's massively anti-Steelers. And that should give him, you know, that gives him a bonus point in the Nottingham fan base straight away. What my request is for everybody, he has to be given a chance. We cannot lose a couple of games at the start of the season if that happens and everybody turns on him straight away. We have to take this goodwill that the club and the fan base have built up over this last 12 months and keep that going into the new season. By all means, we'll probably fall apart at Christmas like we normally do. Well, the last few seasons have been earlier than that.
Yeah, you see, that's part of the problem with having a coach who knows the league, because he knows damn well that we can't handle Christmas.
And before. you know, like I say, I think this is potentially Omar's last roll of the dice. You know, this will be his third season, you know, at the top of the hockey triangle, if you like.
Well, I don't know, because I don't think you can count last season. That's the problem. I think that there's an awful lot of... There's a lot of leeway with last season.
Omar got the coaching appointment right last year.
Yeah,
you know, because if what happened had not happened, I fully expected Panthers to be comfortably fourth. Comfortably fourth. Well, yeah, I mean, I'm gesticulating third, maybe. I'm not quite sure about that, but, you know...
We were better than Cardiff last year.
Well, yeah.
For me. We were only a bit... I mean, everybody was behind Sheffield. Nobody could keep up with Sheffield. They spent the money. They made it sure that they didn't want to take part in the Continental Cup. Yeah. You know, they did everything geared at winning everything last season. Yeah.
And Belfast's
phenomenal. Keith has been phenomenal for Belfast.
He has.
Yes, there's at least one Keith who can keep his job in this world.
But, yeah... I'll go back to what I said a while ago. You know, Omar has got a big job on his hands, because a lot of the fans will grow impatient over the next year or two if there's no clear sign of progress. You know, if we're not, you know, winning considerably more games than losing. And, you know, the last two seasons, last season, unfortunately, because of tragic circumstances, but the year before, we've become a bit of a losing organisation. You know, our record's been about 500 hockey. And that's not good enough for an organisation like the Nottingham Panthers, because like you said, Tina, everything is there. The foundations are all in place to be a roaring success, you know, a massive success. We've got an arena that's great. You know, we've got a passionate fan base. We've got a lot of fans, you know, all the ingredients to be a success. But it's just not happening. I mean, last season, of course, you know, we cut the club leeway because of the absolutely unprecedented circumstances. But, you know, there'll come a point in the not-too-distant future where, you know, the fans' expectations will start to build again, and we'll want teams that can challenge for, you know, the league title and, you know, regularly be in the latter stages of the Challenge Cup and make a mark in the playoffs at the end of the season. So there's a lot of pressure on Omar to get this appointment right. Only time will tell whether it proves to be an inspired choice. But, you know, if this one doesn't work out, and I hope it really does, then yeah, Omar might have to think about doing something completely different.
Okay, so let's talk about the other signings that have been made. So we have had the first signing, actually, the first re-signing.
You don't want to talk about Kevin?
What? To quote the phrase, we need to talk about Kevin, but let's just keep on the Panthers for a little moment. You know, don't upset me too much just yet. So the first re-signing was Otto Nieminen.
And
There it is. Oh dear. You need to practice that. Need to practice that during the summer. That's a fabulous signing, quite frankly. He's obviously very happy in Nottingham, despite, you know, quite a tumultuous year. So that's great to see him back. And then we've had a trio of Brits. We've had Ollie Betteridge. We've got Josh Tetlow. And we've got some sexy Nielsen Hockey still remains in Nottingham. So we're not shaping up too badly right now, I would say. Oh, Jordan, yes.
How can you forget about?
How can I forget about him? I mean, we raved about him on the International Women's Day podcast. So yes, so yeah, we're building up quite nicely. It's nice that we're getting the Brits locked in early. Certainly, definitely a thumbs up from me. So, but with Hazeldine departing up to Glasgow, God damn it, Corey. Sort of leaves a bit of a question mark over the next British signing, really, doesn't it?
Because if Hazeldine was brought in when Tetlow got injured, wasn't he? And we were at, if you're talking about your limits, your squad limits and everything, and the Elite League haven't come out to say they're reducing the import limit or anything.
Nope.
We are at maximum now. Unless you're playing a Brit over an import, we're where we're at. So Hazeldine, yes, I would have loved to have kept him to give us that, because I'm desperate for us to sign spares. Not literally somebody who never plays and only comes in, but I'm desperate for us to sign a squad and choose your starting lineup from a squad of players. And Hazeldine would have massively added to that. Clan have got themselves a good one. They've got themselves a really good one. I'm gutted to see him go, but I'm delighted that we've kept hold of the rest of him. Kelsall's, you know, like I say, he's one of our own now, isn't he, Adam? And Logan was a really good surprise last season, maybe. And hopefully he can build on what he's done. And we've already mentioned Ollie had a really good World Championships. Hopefully that comes in. And again, Tets, you know, now the pair of them are fit again, let's hope they stay fit. And that's key for us next season, full stop. Not having injury after injury after injury after injury after injury.
Isn't it just?
If we can stay injury free next season, that'll only be a benefit.
Yeah,
most definitely.
So, yeah, I pretty much agree with everything Ant said there. You know, the recruitment so far has been promising. Guys are coming back that we want back. I don't think I've seen, maybe with the exception of Tetlow, who seems to be a little bit Marmite, you know, some love him, others not so much. Everyone else is fully in agreement that the guys that have been brought back, you know, deserve to be brought back. And in terms of Nieminen, I mean, quick plug, I went on another podcast, Shock Horror. I did a bit of moonlighting a few weeks ago and went on the IHL Face Off podcast that's hosted by my good friend Jordan and his mate Steve. And, you know, we were sort of recapping on the Panthers season. Go give it a listen if you haven't already heard it. But yeah, we were talking about Nieminen, and I think Steve, who's a Cardiff fan, and Jordan both said that they would have absolutely loved to have Nieminen sign for their teams. So I think they're the sort of signings that you want to make, you know, where other teams are envious about the quality and the calibre of the guys that you're signing, because that means, obviously, you know, our recruitment is, you know, turning heads around the league.
We said it in the last podcast when Noel was here. It's like there is not one team in the league that wouldn't have taken Otto.
Yeah.
Which, and like Adam said, that is exactly the sort of re-signs we want.
Yeah,
most definitely. I mean, so
there aren't really many guys from last year that you'd almost instantly say no out of hand. Of course, you know, there are some players that probably didn't quite play to their full potential, but, you know, there are reasons why. But, you know, I think the difference between last season and other seasons is that you could make a case for any of them coming back again for next season.
Yeah, I mean, we've had teams over the past few seasons, haven't we, where, you know, we couldn't wait to see the back of them. And I can honestly say I don't think that about any player that was on our roster last season. So I saw something in all of them.
Yeah.
And I would be absolutely made up for them to have an opportunity to play with, you know, with a clean slate, essentially.
And I want us to sing Crocodile Rock next
absolutely,
season.
Absolutely, yeah. Hugo, why, you know what to do, man. You know what to do. So, Kevin Moore.
Oh, Kevin.
I told him in bunkers, playoff final weekend Friday, that... I don't know how he did come in. He's such a shy bloke. He just felt so uncomfortable with the attention, and of course we all spotted him. But anyway, I did say to him, if he left Nottingham, there would be tears. And I was correct. But he's got to make the move that's right for him. And I think I think it was you that said, Ant, that you know the feeling was that it was the right time for Danny Stewart to seek alternative employment. So that's probably a move that makes sense for Kevin Moore.
Scott was done a really good interview with him actually on after he signed for Blaze, and it's clear. You know, he would have liked to have stayed at Nottingham, but when there's a head coach opportunity, that's where, you know, he's got his eyes on. Yeah. You can't blame anybody for that. I just hope he gets the support in Coventry. He needs a good assistant coach with him. He needs support from the money people above him. I love the cheesy announcement that they did to announce him using the old Oliver Twist. And then his, what was the baking thing? What was it? Him and his sister.
Yeah, that was something else. I'm not sure what it was, but it was something else.
It was definitely something. I obviously wish him all the best.
Apart from against us.
Yeah. And, you know, be the same for, you know, the reaction with the Coventry fan base. I think a lot of them, you know, wish Danny all the best. They're upset that he's come to Nottingham of all places, but you know they get it. It's close enough to home that he doesn't have to relocate. And the same for Kevin. You know, if he's settled in Nottingham, it's what, an hour down the road to Coventry, isn't it? So yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing what he can put together and seeing what a Kevin Moore team is all about. And we saw him as a mouthpiece, if you like, last season in particular after what happened. No, he goes with all, you know, good luck to him. Hopefully is his success, you know, finishing second place to us as we win everything. I'm quite happy for Coventry to finish second and runners up in both cup finals, you know.
Put your money where your mouth is. Stick some money on that, mate. Yeah, you'll be a very wealthy man.
I'll put a pound on that.
Put a quid, see what happens. I am looking forward to seeing how Kevin deals with me chirping him from behind the bench next season, but you can't let up.
You have to give him exactly what you give everybody else.
Yeah, I think, well, I don't know, maybe Danny Stewart's going to be thankful of the rest.
Danny might be joining in with him, I don't know. Yeah. We'll be looking around here and saying, come on, you gave me more than that.
Yeah, I mean, I'll have to get my thinking cap on and work out what's acceptable. Maybe give it a couple of games. And then I'll just unleash. I don't know. We'll see.
I think Mark Lefebvre has got some rivalry now in not the smartest, but the most outlandish and garishly dressed coach in the Elite League. Because I wonder whether Kevin Moore might take his game up another notch and introduce some really outrageous threads. Because I mean, some of the things that we saw him wearing last season, you know. Some dark sunglasses might have been advisable. But come on, Kevin. Let's see some really quality suits behind that bench at Coventry in the Sky Dome. That would be awesome.
Yeah, we need some suit wars with Favre, don't we?
But I hope we batter him at home. I hope we batter him away. I hope we batter him at neutral venues.
Yep, I can get on board with that. Right, gentlemen, anything else that we want to bring forward for discussion before we wrap up? No? No? Okay, fab. Right.
Oh, we've got pre-season.
Pre-season? Oh, God. I mean, yes, we have got pre-season. Yes, and actually, it's got a little bit of excitement to it this year. I mean, we're not just playing the same teams that we play all over the whole season, and that's great. I love it.
Yeah, it was. It wasn't quite the game against Angers that, you know, I think some of us were hoping to get. It would have been nice to say, you know, cheerio to JP properly.
That would have been lovely.
But, you know, to play a team from the Canadian U Sports, that'll be a really good test. I think they play, you know, similar level to the, was it the Friendship Four that they have in Belfast? It's that sort of level, isn't it?
That's what it feels like, yes.
Yeah. And then, yeah, to get the the Germans over is terrific. And it's something we've been crying out for. It's like the last few seasons, yes, you know, at the end of the day, the Nottingham-Sheffield games are the ones that attract the crowd. But from us, you know, the people that go regularly, I think we'd about have enough. You just saw the reaction to from the Steelers fan base alone when they announced their pre-season game against us. It was massively underwhelming.
It's in the ensuite.
Yeah, it's in the ensuite as well. I completely forgot about that.
Are they going to not allocate any tickets to us again? I mean, is that the standard now?
Who knows? But I mean, the vast majority of their fans they've had enough of playing us over the course of the season, which is a bit weird considering they win all the time, you know. I know they're in. You know, we do see them a lot, but it's nice to get a pre-season game against Manchester as well. I know it's only away. It's nice to see, you know, a different pre-season, if you like. And then I'm assuming that home weekend against Cardiff will be some kind of Gary Moran Aladdin Cup trophy thing, won't it? But it's good. It's good to see a bit of variety. Variety is a spice of life, as you speak. And we're not just playing Saturday, Sunday as well. They've mixed it up a bit. We've got a Friday game and a Monday game as well. So.
Yeah, I love it. Ambition. Is that word again? Ambition. I think, gentlemen, I think I may have already established, reading between the lines, that you're both all in. Is this a decision that you're both probably going to be all in? So pre-season will be included. Adam, can we sort of take from that you are probably going to be there for said pre-season games, cricket schedule allowing,
but yeah, I mean, I'm all in. I think that's a great idea, by the way. Not sure whether I've said that on a podcast, but
I feel like, did we talk about, did, had it happened
yeah,
in the last
did
podcast?
We,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Well, it's still a good decision.
It is, yeah, very much so.
But yeah, excited to see a little bit of different hockey, you know, because familiarity breeds contempt, I think, is the old phrase. So
ding, 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 ding.
There we are, catchphrase bingo. I've just won top prize. Good to see different styles of hockey. You know, we don't want to see Sheffield 25,000 times a season, and you know, Cardiff so many times. Although, admittedly, you know, that's one of the teams we are playing.
One of the teams we're playing, yeah.
But it's always nice to see new clubs come over. I think maybe Dundee and Fife started something off last season, didn't they? Because they brought over a couple of teams from I think there's a Romanian team that came over last year.
They were definitely European, and I mean, I know what he's saying. Yeah,
it was up in Scotland.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, I mean, Manchester have you know, been in collaboration here, haven't they? Because they're playing the same two teams. So, and that's kind of what you need to do. You know, you need to collaborate in that sort of way. Yeah.
Yeah, work together and bring some new teams to these shores. You know. See different hockey, different players, you know, it's going to be exciting. I'm looking forward to those games. It's actually, you know, it's just refreshing to look forward to a pre-season game without thinking, oh great, it's the first of 10 games against that lot. So well done to whoever and everyone that made it happen.
Yeah, very much so.
It will affect the coffers. Because we haven't got that bumper crowd against Sheffield, so I just hope the fans now react to this and back it and get down in their numbers. Like I say, I think if those lot that have gone all in, you know, it's the pre-season games are included, so unless you're festival in or cricketing, then there's no reason why you can't get out. It's good, and as weird as it is, we talk about how we're fed up with playing Steelers all the time. I'm not that fed up with playing Cardiff. And I've realised why. It's like, because we actually have a quite good record against Cardiff at the NIC. And obviously we've touched on the fact that we can't beat Sheffield for love nor money. So maybe that's it.
It's going to change under Danny Stewart. We're going to have an incredible record for the next 20 years against Sheffield.
Oh, you heard it here, folks.
Have been saved.
Yeah, Danny Stewart, Santa Claus in disguise.
He saved Christmas,
yeah.
There's going to be a statue built of Danny next to the statue of Rick and Corey that we're still waiting for, with his treble trophies and his winning record over the Sheffield Steelers.
Yeah, you heard it here first, folks. Ant and Adam are playing Mystic Meg.
Have we convinced you yet?
No, not at all. There's still work to do there, I'm afraid, chaps. Right, I think we'll leave it there. It's already quite a lengthy podcast. I don't think any of us expected. We never do. We never expect to talk this long, and somehow we do. So thanks for sticking with us once again. So we've made reference several times to the chat that Ant had with Scott Findlay and Lewis Callant. We're going to put that out as a separate podcast, so you can sort of take that in at your leisure, and perhaps not have to pause and come back to us and wonder if your podcast software is actually going to pick up at the right point. So, yeah, thank you very much. We'll be back again in an indeterminate amount of time when there are more things to talk about. Hopefully more signings, more news. Get Crocodile Rock Q, don't my friend.
Come on, man, just answer it. Answer the call.
Sign
contract.
You know what to do, Hugo. Right. Thanks very much once again for listening and your continued support of our little podcast. And it's cheerio from Ant.
Cheerio from Ant.
And Adam.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Bye.
And from myself. We'll see you next time. Ta-da.